So here's the basic chemistry of sulfide mining. This is not a secret. This is well known to anyone that understands basic chemistry. You take a sulfide ore body, and before that ore body is extracted, you have a fresh or a healthy ecosystem supporting fish populations and other aquatic life. You expose this aquatic environment to sulfide mineralization under the pressure of air and water, creating sulfuric acid and releasing heavy metals into the environment, creating a toxic environment for any aquatic or any kind of living organism. The best estimate we have on the basis of existing sulfide mining operations is that this industry will pollute 27 billion gallons of water, fresh water, per year. And that is all because of this well-known chemical process of acid mine drainage. This is what acid mine drainage looks like. It's a discoloration of streams and rivers that are the recipient of waste material from the mining process. And of course, some of the most important heavy metals that are released that are extremely toxic to both aquatic organisms and human beings are arsenic, lead, and mercury, all of which cause innumerable health problems that I'm not going to go into, but if you're interested, all you have to do is Google acid mine drainage and heavy metal contamination, and you'll get a long list of health effects, adverse health effects from exposure to these metals. Now, I said at the very beginning, you take a ton of rock, you get 3 pounds of copper or zinc, 1,997 pounds end up as waste material. That waste material is called tailings. The tailings are what comes out of the milling process, where they pulverize, crush the rock, put all sorts of harsh chemicals in the processing, including cyanide and sulfuric acid. And at the end of that process, you end up with a fine, sandy material having the consistency of talcum powder. You have talcum powder piled hundreds of feet high, a mile wide, in these structures conveniently and mislabeled as tailings containment areas. The last thing these facilities do is contain the tailings. Now, you have in this diagram, which is taken from a mining publication, you have what the industry called dike walls, supposedly holding up the entire tailings disposal facility and the fine, sandy, talcum-like material. But the material that's holding up the other waste material is simply more fine, sandy material. It's not any kind of permanent structure. Notice also that there is a provision for the leakage in the tailings area because they have seepage collection ditches where they collect all the seepage that comes out of the tailings area. So when you have rainfall that flows through the tailings area, it's like pouring water through coffee grounds, except at the bottom you don't get coffee, you get toxic liquid. That toxic liquid is collected and recirculated in a waste treatment plant so that it can be discharged to surface waters. Now that is the ideal scenario during the life of the mine. What happens after the mine closes, after 10, 20 years? There's no wastewater treatment plant anymore. The company may have gone bankrupt. Who is going to collect the wastewater? And who is going to make sure that that wastewater does not enter the groundwater and the surface water? No one, or if there is anyone, is going to be at taxpayer expense. This is the unaccountable part of the mining process, which is what is the responsibility of the company versus what is the responsibility of the public for handling this waste material, which is going to be there in perpetuity. And of course, the problem with these waste containment areas is that they rarely contain all the wastes. So in the modern era, we have modern mining technology like the one that ended up in January 2000 with a spill of 100 tons of cyanide contaminated water that was released into the Tisza River in Hungary, destroying 1,400 tons of fish, the livelihoods of the entire fishing industry along the Tisza River, and the shutdown of drinking water supplies that depended upon the Tisza River as a source of their drinking water along Romanian and Hungarian towns. Now, these kind of accidents, whether with cyanide materials or other toxic chemicals, are such a frequent occurrence in the mining industry that voters in Montana banned the use of cyanide in mining in 1998, the Czech Republic banned it in 2000, and the Menominee County Board, which is where Aquila has its home base of operations, right next to the proposed mine site, even the Menominee County Board has passed a resolution opposing the use of cyanide in Menominee County. Now, the industry will tell you that these kind of accidents are rare occurrences, that they've learned from the past mistakes, and that the new generation of mining control technology is much better than it was in the past, and the public should be reassured that these events are unlikely to happen. All of that is complete and total nonsense. The best material we have on what the actual record of the industry is coming from a study that shows that waste failures are increasing in frequency, severity, and cost all around the world. It's not hard to understand why these accidents are increasing in size, cost, and frequency, because all it involves is an understanding of elemental geology, which is that the richest veins of copper and zinc and gold have already been mined out. Right? What is left in the Earth's crust are trace quantities of these metals. And in order to make a profit off of extracting these trace quantities of metals, you have to expand your scope of operations to include vast open pits that discharge and dislodge large amounts of rock that contain tiny amounts of metals. And when you do that, what you end up with is a large amount of waste. The larger the open pit, the larger the waste material that has to be contained. So you take a 1 ounce quantity of gold in your average gold wedding ring or your gold graduation ring, that 1 ounce of gold resulted in 20 tons of toxic waste. 1 ounce of gold, 20 tons of toxic waste, that is the ratio that is the standard in the industry, meaning that those tons of waste have to be contained in perpetuity in structures that were never designed during a period of awareness of climate change and what climate change bodes in terms of increasing frequency and severity of storms, precipitation, tornadoes, hurricanes, like we've seen in the last month all over the world. Those kind of events were not part of the engineering that went into the design of these tailings ponds. These tailings ponds are pre-climate change, and so all of these events that we now take for granted that are going to impinge on the stability of these tailings areas were never designed to withstand those kind of events. So we have nearly half of all recorded serious failures happened in modern times between 1990 and 2010. This is not something from the 19th century or even the 20th century. This is something that's happening now and that will happen with increasing frequency and severity and cost in the future. Now, to give you some sense of why this is severe, I mean, look at the height of some of these tailings areas. 500 feet, which is the height of the Washington Monument. 700 feet, the height of the Hoover Dam. 748 feet, the height of the New York Times building. Right, these are vast, unstable structures waiting to be affected by forces of nature that human beings have no control over. And so, it's not accidental that in the most experienced mining country in the world, in Canada, where there's more mining than any other place on Earth, in 2014, you had 1 billion gallons of mining waste spilling into rivers from a tailings dam at the Mount Pulley Gold Mine, at the headwaters of the Fraser River in British Columbia. The downstream communities were mostly indigenous communities who depended upon the river for their drinking water and for their subsistence. Aquila, which is the company proposing this open pit sulfide mine on the Michigan-Wisconsin border, only minimally addresses the potential impacts of accidents or spills, dismissing potential impacts as minimal. I wouldn't call 1 billion gallons of mine waste suddenly being discharged into a major river as a minimal event. Aquila thinks that this is a minimal event, and therefore they do not have to discuss it, and they do not have to disclose what the chances are of that happening at the proposed Back 40 mine site. Again, a misrepresentation of what is being planned for downstream communities on the Michigan-Wisconsin border. Now notice, here is the fine sandy material I talked about earlier, having the consistency of talcum powder. This is where the breach occurred. This breach, in fact, was not the result of a severe weather event. This was a breach that was a direct result of the cost-cutting measures of the mining company. The mining company was producing large amounts of waste that needed to be contained in a larger area, and instead of applying for a permit to expand the scope of their waste disposal area, which would require time, effort, and money, they simply bypassed the entire permit process, and they simply expanded their waste material, not horizontally, but vertically. They simply piled hundreds of millions of more tons of tailings on the already unstable structure that was already in place. And you add 100% more waste material onto an already fragile structure underlying the entire tailings area, and you crack the bedrock underneath. There's only so much weight that can be applied to even rock material under the tailings area before it cracks. And once that cracks, you create a breach, and that is what happened at the Mount Pollard mine in August of 2014. This is the same Fraser River a month after the spill, and you can see already that the precipitation of the toxic materials in the waste material has already infiltrated the entire environment. It's incorporated into the sediments, into the soils, and into the shoreline along the river, and it will be there for how long? We don't know, because there's never been a successful cleanup of this kind of spill. This, by the way, this mine was promoted by the mining industry as an example of how sulfide mining can coexist with clean water. Well, that wasn't a very good demonstration. It didn't happen. Scientists say it is virtually impossible to clean up the mess left behind the spill. That is why the Menominee River has been declared by the American Rivers Group as one of the 10 most endangered rivers in America from the threat of open pit sulfide mining. Aquila provides almost no information on the impacts of the spill, how long this impact could last, and whether the impacts could be reversed, another violation of the transparency requirements of the environmental review process.